Greetings. If you are Muslim, I invite you to hear the truth, the basis of the gospel of Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. Part 1 began our examination of John the Baptist, the first messenger of Malachi 3:1. Jesus spoke about John and applied the words of Malachi 3:1 to John. Luke 7:27. This is he of whom it is written, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you." In part 1, we examined the fact that Jesus personalized the words of Malachi 3:1. Let's stay on this point just a bit longer, and then we'll move on to other elements of John's importance. Just as many events and stories and teachings occur in more than one of the four Gospels, so does Jesus' attribution. Matthew 11:10. This is the one about whom it is written, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you." And if you examine the context, this is the same as Luke's. Jesus asking in Matthew 11:7 through 9, asking, "What did you go out to see?" Excellent. Confirmation by two witnesses retelling the same accounts. And there is a third rendition of this same concept. Mark 1:2. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way." The voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Here in Mark, these two verses make the point I've been trying to raise. Mark 1:2, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way." The voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." But these two verses do not appear together in the scriptures. "Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way." This first section is Malachi 3:1, part A, while the second is Isaiah 40, verse 3. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." These are actually conflated together because the connection is so obvious. And part of the mission or charter of the disciples and authors of the four Gospels was to record the truth. And while conflating the two verses was startling when I saw it, the context that introduces it is even more striking. Mark 1:1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The beginning of the gospel. My struggle here is how to communicate just how amazing this information is. Mark 1:1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, this could simply be the way Mark chose to start his message, like, "Call me Ishmael," from Moby Dick. Or, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times." But perhaps Mark is revealing a deeper truth. Mark is about to give you the foundation, the beginning, the message of the prophets that foretold about Jesus, the Son of God. The revelation that proves Jesus is God without Jesus needing to say, "I am God." Mark 1:1, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mark continues with verse 2 and 3. Mark 1:2 and Mark 1:3. And by conjoining them, identifies John as the voice Isaiah foretold. Mark 1:2 quotes Malachi 3:1, specifically the first prophet to come, while Mark 1:3 quotes Isaiah 40, verse 3, the voice to prepare the way for Yahweh, God in the earth. which implies the real beginning of the gospel of Jesus, the Son of God, came by Malachi and Isaiah. If you are Muslim, I beg you to actually listen and understand what God has sent down by His prophets. The Old Testament and New Testament are perfect brothers in what they reveal. And there is even more. In Luke 7:37, Jesus says, John fulfills Malachi 3:1. The same is recounted in Matthew 11:10. Luke 3:4 affirms John is the voice Isaiah foretold. John 1:23 is John himself claiming he is the voice. I'm sorry, Muslims, but you cannot claim that Paul created the Jesus is God revelation. Prophets Malachi, Isaiah, John, and Jesus conspired to reveal that. And I am sure others too conspired with God who sent them to confirm this truth. Prophet Jeremiah foretold of God's new covenant that Malachi confirms. If you are Muslim, you should honestly question the accusation that the Bible has been corrupted. The more complicated the planned revelation of God is, the harder it is to fake or corrupt. Prophet Jesus confirmed he established the new covenant in Matthew 26:28. Now, I'll give you a slide here where you can pause and capture this image in your mind or with your pen. Is John important? Well, the diagram, or the network, is really about establishing the identities of the two men. Ultimately, it is about proving Jesus is God come in the flesh. Maybe, just maybe, God did this so that Jesus did not have to say, "I am God." John is critical because he helps establish the credentials of who Jesus is. God in the flesh, come to his temple. And Jesus himself makes another very bold statement about John. Matthew 11:11. Truly I tell you, among those born of women, there has risen no one greater than John the Baptist. No one. Not Abraham, not David, not Solomon, not Zechariah, not Daniel, not Jeremiah, not Isaiah. Prophet John is equal to the best of any of them. And as we'll see in the next video, the supernatural events around John were unique as well. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.